If you got your Bibles, let's turn to Book of Acts, chapter 1, and I'll read from verses 1, 4 to 8. Acts chapter 1, verses reading 4 to 8. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me, for John truly baptized with water, but he shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they were therefore come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the season which the Father had put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Let's pray. Gracious Father, I come to you. Lord, I thank you for the word. Help me, O God, as I minister the word to the let the Holy Spirit take control of us, and I commit each one in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning's topic has been with this whole month we have been talking on Holy Spirit. Remember about 2 weeks ago, on the 9th of June, we had celebrated Pentecost Day. And Holy Spirit came 50 days after the resurrection of Jesus and 10 days after his ascension. And that time, Jews of many nations gathered in Jerusalem for this festival, and it resulted in a worldwide harvest of new believers, the first convert of Christianity. Now, this is the fulfillment of John the Baptist, who word when he said that about the Holy Spirit baptizing in fire, and the prophet Joel said about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. It's like, why the tongues of fire? Tongue symbolizes speech and communication of the gospel. And cloven tongue means the fire separated and rested upon each one of them. Fire symbolizes God's purifying presence, which bends away undesirable elements in our lives and sets a heart aflame to ignite others' life, in others' life. On Mount Sinai, God confirmed the validity of the Old Testament law with fire from heaven. At Pentecost, God confirmed the validity of the Holy Spirit ministering by sending fire on all the believers that were gathered there. And it symbolizes that God's presence is now available to on all believers and all who believe in him. God made his presence to this group of believers in a very spectral way. A roaring wind, fire, and his Holy Spirit. Would you like God to reveal himself in such a reconcilable way? In 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 10 to 31, Elijah also needed a message from God. And there was a mighty wind, then an earthquake, and finally the fire. But God's message came in a very small, still voice. God may use dramatic methods to walk in our lives, or he may speak in a gentle whisper. Wait patiently and listen. Always listen. These people literally spoke in other languages. You know, it was a miracle. Those that were there waiting, they had received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They spoke in all different languages. And you know, it was an international crowd there from all country. And that drew attention. It was a miracle. That drew attention. And they saw the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Look at the apostle continued to minister in the power of the Holy Spirit wherever they went. You know one thing, Christianity is not limited to one particular race or one group of people. Christ offers salvation to all people without regard of its nationality. You know, you look at in the day of Pentecost, the visitors in Jerusalem were surprised to hear the believers speaking in languages other than their own. But there need not have been, you know, it was God's miracle. And that is how the word of God, the gospel, was preached all over. It spread. And it was like when you look at the Bible, there are so many different nationalities there and the languages, and the places are mentioned in the Bible, but the list of many lands from which the Jews came to the festival in Jerusalem. These Jews were not living in Palestine, but for that festival they had come in that place in Jerusalem. And after listening to Peter's message, they were changed. Some of them came back in their homeland with God's good news of salvation. And that is how God prepares the way for the spread of the gospel. You look at Peter tells the people why he should listen and to believe, because in the Old Testament prophecy has been entirely fulfilled in Jesus. Because Jesus is the Messiah, and because he has risen, Christ can change lives. We look at Peter, he was a very unstable leader. During Jesus' ministry, letting his bravado and his downfall, even denying that he did not know Jesus. But Christ has forgiven him and restored him. This is how new Peter, humble and bold. His confidence came from the Holy Spirit, who made him a powerful and dynamic preacher. Have you ever felt as if you made such a mistake that God will not forgive you or use you? No matter what your sins are, what you have committed, God promises to forgive and makes you useful in his kingdom. Allow him to forgive you and use you effectively and to serve you. The last day includes all the days between Christ's first and second coming, and is another way of saying from now on. The day of the Lord, the whole Christian age, even Moses aimed for the Lord to pour the Holy Spirit on everyone. At Pentecost, the Holy Spirit was released throughout the entire world. Men, women, and sons and daughters, Jews and Gentiles, all received the Holy Spirit. This was a revolutionary thought of the first century Jews. After Peter's powerful, spirit-filled message, that people were deeply moved and asked, what shall I do? This is a basic question we must ask. What shall I do? It is not enough to be sorry for your sins, but must ask God to forgive. God has spoken through his word and through his word to another believer. When Peter preached the good news about Christ, these new Christians were joined with other believers and taught by the apostles. They concluded in prayer meetings and fellowship. New believers need Christ to be in the group of believers where they can learn God's word and pray and mature in faith. The Holy Spirit was poured out on Pentecost. That's 50 days after Christ's resurrection. And Zechariah calls the Spirit of grace and supplication. He's the Spirit who convicts us of sin. reveals us to God's righteousness and judgment. Help us to, as we pray, help with our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray, for as we ought, the Spirit itself taketh intercession for us. It gives us boldness to speak. Like, it's hard for me sometimes to, you know, speak. But when the Holy Spirit comes, it helps me and gives me. And I'm thankful for the Lord, that of the Holy Spirit. Jesus told the disciples when they arrested for preaching the gospel that they should not worry what they're going to say or defend themselves, because God is going to give the Holy Spirit to speak through them. Holy Spirit changes our heart. Matthew chapter 12, verse 34 to 36. Jesus reminds us that what we say reveals it in our heart. What your heart is like. You can't solve your heart problem. However, we must allow the Holy Spirit to fill us with new attitudes and motives. A healthy Christian community attracts people to Christ. The Jerusalem church zeal for worship and brotherly love was contagious. You know, it just spread like wildfire because of the Holy Spirit. What are we doing to make our church the kind of place that will attract others to Christ? In Matthew 28:19-20, it says, Jesus instructed his disciples to witness to all nations, but they were told to wait first for the Holy Spirit. God has important work for us to do for him, but we must do it by the power of the Holy Spirit. We often like to get on with our jobs, even if it means running ahead of God. But waiting is sometimes part of God's plan. Are you waiting and listening for God's complete instruction? Or are you running ahead of his plans? We need God's timing power to be truly effective. At Pentecost, the Holy Spirit was made available to all who believed in Jesus. The Spirit is the power of our new lives. When we are baptized by the Holy Spirit, power from the Holy Spirit is not limited to strength. The Holy Spirit marks the beginning of Christian experience. We cannot belong to Christ without his Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. We cannot be in the body of Christ except by baptism in the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12, 3. The Spirit is the power of our new lives. He begins a lifelong process of change in us. When we receive Christ by faith, we begin an immediate personal relationship with God. The Holy Spirit works in us to help us become like Christ. The Spirit unites the Christian community in Christ. Ephesians 2, 19-22. The Holy Spirit can be experienced by all, and he works through all. And 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 11. You look at during the years of Jesus' ministry on earth, the disciples continually wondered about his kingdom, when he would come. What would be the role? In traditional view, the Messiah would be an earthly conqueror who would free Israel from Rome. But the kingdom that Jesus was talking about first was a spiritual kingdom established in the hearts and lives of believers. In Luke 17:21, we read, God's presence and power dwells in believers. In the presence of the Holy Spirit. Power from Holy Spirit is not limited to strength beyond ordinary. That power also involves courage, boldness, confidence, insight, ability, and authority. The disciples will need all these gifts to fulfill their mission. If you believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior, you can experience the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. Notice the progression. They would receive Holy Spirit, and he would give them power, and they would be witnesses with extraordinary result. We often try to reverse the order and witness by our own power and telling what God has done for us. After Christ ascended into heaven, the disciples immediately returned to Jerusalem and had a prayer meeting. Jesus said they would be baptized with the Holy Spirit in a few days. So they waited and prayed. How long do we wait and pray and ask the Holy Spirit? When you face a difficult task or important decision or a baffling dilemma, don't rush into the work and just hope it happens the way it should. Instead, your first step should be to pray for the Holy Spirit's power and guidance. The Holy Spirit guarantees that we belong to God and will receive all his benefits, because it's Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14. The Holy Spirit guarantees that salvation is ours now and that we receive so much more when Christ returns. The Holy Spirit gives this life is a forecast or down payment of the benefits of our external life in God's presence. With the privilege of belonging to God comes the responsibility of identifying ourselves as his faithful servant. Don't be ashamed to let others know that you are his. Jesus promised the disciples that when they would receive the Holy Spirit, he would give them power. They would be witnesses. If God's gospel has to reach its final destination, if someone in your family, your workplace, your school, your community hasn't heard about Jesus Christ, ask Jesus to baptize you with the Holy Spirit so you may be able to witness. The Spirit marks the beginning of Christian experience. The Spirit is the power of new lives. The Spirit unites the community. The Holy Spirit can be experienced by all and through all. I remember when we were in Flagstaff Church in those early 50s, 60s. We used to go to church early in the morning about 4 o'clock, 5, to wait for the infilling of the Holy Spirit. We were longing, we were hungry for it. Are you hungry today for the Holy Spirit? God is still pouring what he used to do. He's still the same God we are serving. He, if you ask diligently, if you pray and seek, and God will fill you with his Holy Spirit. Because God has promised that. Seek and you shall find. God is going to. And when we used to come in the morning to church, we used to go to prayer room instead of Talanoa. We used to go and pray, asking God in guidance. Still, we can do today. We're spending more time talking than to others than talking to God. And that's what we need, the Holy Spirit to guide us and help us to, in this living at this time, that we really need the power of the Holy Spirit. Because we have a commission to fulfill, and that is to witness to others. How many of our family members, they don't know Christ? What are we doing? How many of our friends are slipping away in hell? Our schoolmates, our workmates, we haven't witnessed to them. Today is the time when we seek, Lord, Lord, give me courage, give me boldness to go out and witness to these people. It's all you have today. What God has done in your life, you are witnessing. It's not what you have done, but what God has done in your life. That is what we are supposed to tell others, so that they will not slip away into hell, but come to know the saving grace of the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious Father, I come to you this morning. Thank you, Lord. Help us, O God, that you continue to serve you, that the Holy Spirit is still available today when we seek, Lord, that you will pour out your Spirit. And I thank you, Lord, for all those who are present, that they will unitedly lift up their voice and ask, Lord, for your outpouring. And I, Lord, your presence will be felt here, and I know your gospel will be preached boldly throughout. In spite of the persecution, Lord, we know you are there always, and your spirit will guide us and draw us. Thank you, Lord, and I commit to this day and this each one of us in your hands, in Jesus' name. Amen.